The following is a production of DallasCowboys.com and the Dallas Cowboys Football Club.
How about them Cowboys?
Yeah! Go Cowboys!
This is Girls Talk Boys Talk, presented by Jigsaw Dating, preferred dating partner of the Dallas Cowboys, and broadcasting live from Dallas Cowboys World Headquarters at the Star.
I hate that you just said that, Jesse. Welcome into Girls Talk Boys Talk, presented by Jigsaw, the preferred dating partner of the Dallas Cowboy. Apparently it's May the 4th, and I'm going to do my best to avoid all of the things Star Wars today, because it's my least between that and the "it's going to be May" memes.
Oh,
hate it.
You have to do it, though. Like, somebody has to do it.
Hate it. I'm a hater. I hate those. But regardless, Girls Talk, Boys Talk, Ailey Sutton, Jess Navarez, and Aisha Morrison with you. We've got a lot to talk about, ladies. It feels like it's been 100 million days since we've had a chance to talk because so much has happened. Obviously, we had the draft wrapped up last week. We'll get into that in a little bit. The players are out on the field. Voluntary workouts are underway. So a lot of the guys are here in the building getting ready for training camp, which will be here before you know it. They already have a countdown in the cafeteria for us, which is a little bit insulting because we want to enjoy our off season, but that's okay.
What off season?
What off season?
There you go.
What is that? There is a countdown. Before we get to training camp, let's talk about last night. Still running a little bit on fumes after wrapping up that home run derby over at Writers Field. But I got to say, it was so fun to be just involved in the production and getting to see the players, you know, kind of in their element. Some of them were very good at baseball. Some of them could use some practice at the batting cages.
Yeah.
But listen, they raised over $100,000 for various charities around the country, the bulk of that going to the Salvation Army, but still just a really incredible night to get to see the guys out, have some fun. Our first opportunity to get to chat with Brandon Cooks and Stephon Gilmore. So a lot of fun things happening there. Jess, I kind of want to pivot over to you a little bit because you were working double time between being on the field and then running into the dugout and talking to the players. So I just want to go to you first. What stood out to you about those conversations? I know there were several guys over there. Dak spoke, Micah Parsons, CeeDee Lamb. Of course, like I said, we heard from Brandon and Stephon. But what stood out to you in those conversations?
First of all, I have to give you your kudos for being the greatest MC. I mean, Haley kept her energy up the entire time. And it's funny because I was listening back to the audio to have notes to take. And I, like, at some point, I kind of veered away from listening to some of the guys because I was listening to you MC. And I was like, my girl just keeps the energy. She was amazing. And all the kudos to you because that crowd was, they stayed hyped.
Yeah.
Let me say, that was a great crowd of people
out
there. Thank
you. Yeah, that was my first time really doing anything like that. So I hope I did just fine.
You did amazing.
We'll see next year if they call me back.
You did amazing. And you know what? Use me as a reference. I'll hype you up anytime. But no, you know, we got to talk to a lot of the guys. And it's really cool to see the guys in this kind of setting because, you know, we're used to talking to them pre-game, post-game, kind of when the pressure is just really high on them to be perfect. And this, in this element, they're there for charity. And they're there seeing the adoring fans and the kids. And, I mean, there was like a group of kids over there by the dugout.
They loved Micah.
They were all about Micah. One was about Leighton a lot. He was like, Leighton Van Der Esch. And we're trying to interview him. And Leighton kept kind of like stopping and looking. But, no, we got a lot of really good takeaways out of this. And somebody that I really wanted to talk to post-draft was Jake Ferguson, and not just post-draft but also post-Dalton Schultz, you know, and all the speculation of who's tight end one now, how does that work, and Jake has paid his dues, so I was so excited to talk to him. He talked about how this is a room full of Big Ten guys now, and that this is a good tight end room because Big Ten tight ends are the best in his opinion, and they're reliable, which is something you need within a tight end. He talked about how the strength within that tight end room is really that every guy can be themselves, and they bring a different element that makes it a stronger unit as a whole. He said that he worked on maturing this offseason, whether that was his footwork, whether that was just him personally in personal growth, which we love to hear, personal growth as far as just being a human in general, and that his goal is to just perfect those things. Also talking about that second year jump, that's a big term we really use around this building. And he said, being a locker room leader, that is what I want to do. I want to take that big jump to be that guy. Because I asked him, look, with Dalton Schultz, we always hear that that tight end room would look at him as a big brother. And I said, how do you step into that big brother role, essentially, because that's what you have? And he said, you know, we're the four horsemen, we're just adding another guy. So I'm excited to hear even more of what that tight end room has to say. But I love talking to him. Brandon Cooks, he was so excited to be there. And it was just really cool to see him. I asked him, what is it like for you to see Cowboys Nation as a whole right now? And he was like, it's a testament to the city and the fans in it, because those fans were, they were doing their due diligence. They were really hype. He talked about CeeDee. He said he's always been a playmaker since he entered the league, and now I just get to work with him. He said that he personally brings a dynamic aspect to this offense, which we know, we've studied, we've talked about. But something that really stood out to me in general, and this was echoed not just with him, but CeeDee mentioned it and Dak mentioned it, is something he brings is something he actually used from, or learned, I should say, from Drew Brees, which is how to take care of your body outside of football.
Wow.
Eating right, staying healthy. And he echoed, I want to teach those young guys how to do that so their career can really stay, you know, healthy long term. And he said, that's why I'm able to be so productive and have all that ball behind me, because I take care and I invest in my body. Dak even echoed this. Dak said, just seeing what he can do outside of just football and how he takes care of himself. CeeDee mentioned it, so I thought that was a really cool aspect. As for Stephon Gilmore, he talked about Dan lets players play their game. And I loved this. I loved that he was giving his flowers to Dan Quinn. And, you know, there was some health concerns that he was questioned about. And he said, this is the best I've felt in 2 to 3 years. So I'm ready to play. All the guys just, they look so refreshed and so excited to get back on the field. So, I mean, I could go on and on about this. But basically, long story short, your Dallas Cowboys are ready to go. They're in lock. They look great. They sound great. And you can just feel the excitement.
They like each other.
Yeah.
Oh,
they like each other.
Amazing.
Like, I mean, I'm glad that you mentioned Stephon talking about Dan Quinn and that Dan lets you play your game. One thing about Brandon Cooks also, too, people were talking about just how excited, you guys even mentioned just how excited he seems. And I'm like, yeah, y'all, like, he definitely feels wanted here. He definitely feels comfortable here.
Mm-hmm.
And the point that you made about his body, Jess, and just the way he takes care of it and how he's kind of modeling to the other guys, it's such an important element of the game.
Yeah.
And that's something I hadn't even thought about, is that he could teach those guys how to have longevity. Because sometimes when we think about Brandon Cooks, it feels like he's been in the league so long.
But he really hasn't.
Yeah. He just, so I mean, he stays
looking young.
29 this year, if I'm not mistaken. And so it feels like his tenure has been so long, but it hasn't been that long. He's just taking care of his body and been productive everywhere he goes. So thank you for bringing up that point.
Girl, drinking out of the fountain of youth. I mean,
I know.
I want to ask him, I'm like, wait, no, what are your pointers, though?
Listen,
like, I want to know.
What's your skincare routine?
Listen.
Let's go down all of it. What do you eat?
Are you exfoliating regularly?
Can we get a TikTok video?
Get ready with me for the home run derby.
What if he does that? Y'all maybe need to talk to the media team.
No, really. Can you do something like that? Because I'm dying to know.
I make no promises, but it's definitely something that I would be interested in working with. So Brandon Cooks, he's probably not listening because I assume he's out on that practice field working out. But yeah, we'll see if we can get Brandon Cooks skincare, healthcare. If it involves crystals, though, we might have to pivot because we can't do the crystals. While we're sitting here, ladies, it's interesting.
You'll never drop that. Oh, my goodness. You know.
It's interesting because I'm looking at our one of our television screens that we have in here, and Good Morning Football is on NFL Network, and they're ranking NFC quarterbacks.
Yeah.
I believe, I saw it briefly, I was looking for Dak. I believe Jalen Hurts was the only quarterback that he had up in the top tier as his number one rankings. But then, there we go. Yeah, Jalen Hurts, and then Dak Prescott is in the second tier next to Kirk Cousins and Matthew Stafford. And I just, since we all had that same issue, and again, getting to hear from Dak yesterday, what are our thoughts on Dak Prescott being ranked second? But with Matt Stafford and Kirk Cousins,
it's just relevancy. Yeah. It's relevancy of the fact that Jalen Hurts just went to a Super Bowl. Like, because when you look at the quarterback position and how it's a progressive position for most guys, it's not something that happens overnight. Jalen Hurts improved so much last year, but he's still a work in progress.
Sure.
And to put him over a quarterback that's been doing this for as long as Dak has the records that Dak has, it's insulting at this point. And I said it yesterday on Twitter, is that I'm at a point to where I just don't even acknowledge it anymore. You can't prove to people that Dak Prescott is a good quarterback. There's enough evidence to see it. But Jalen did just go to a Super Bowl, so woo-woo.
We did hear from Dak yesterday, too, and he talked about how right now the plan of action is making the new plays that are going into this new Mike McCarthy run offensive scheme and really learning them and perfecting them. That's kind of where they're at right now. He did talk about obviously adding Brandon Cooks, and I'm not going to repeat word for word what he said because it does not involve a nice word, but let's just say he was excited. He said, you know, somebody asked him, how can Brandon Cooks help you? And he said, cuss word, yes. And
cuss word, yes.
He was really adamant about what a help he is. And then again, he echoed that he takes care of his body and he's teaching everybody that. And then CeeDee talked. And what I loved about this, too, was that CeeDee talked about, you know, everyone's talking about veteran leadership from Brandon Cooks. What are you picking his brain about? And he said, I've picked every guy's brain that has come ahead of me since I got into this league. So I loved that. But Dak overall, I mean, yeah, we're not even going to pay attention to that.
Yeah, he got
to
be excited, though, Dak. We were talking about it on the draft show yesterday, is that the team speed on the offensive side of the ball is changing. Like, a player like Brandon Cooks, you bring in a Deuce Vaughn. Mm-hmm, like, it's starting to feel different on that side of the ball as far as how fast they want to play and some of the things they want to do. And that's something I feel like the Cowboys have lacked for a while, is, like, speedy guys that can change. Even Tony, like, change of pace guys who can really come in and you see them jump off the screen. That's something I'm excited about also. So I know he's excited to have slot receivers, because he has not had a true slot since Cole Beasley, and we saw how well he performed when he had a true slot receiver. So,
yeah, we'll see. It'll be interesting. I know Dak is out there working. He's been working all summer with a lot of these new guys, and that to me is the most exciting part, is just knowing, you know, we've never questioned his commitment to what it takes to be successful every year, but just the dedication that he's taken late in his career in, you know, mentoring the young kids, bringing them along, making them feel welcome, so that when they show up for rookie training camp or when they show up for, you know, OTAs and training camp coming up this summer, they won't feel like it's such a new thing. They feel comfortable. And they feel comfortable because they're doing it with QB1. Mm-hmm. So that's something that's really impressed me throughout this offseason. You teased draft talk a little bit. So let's go ahead and take our first break here. When we come back, there's a lot to dive in with this draft class. I'm excited. I know you ladies are excited for our new faces coming in. We'll get into that on the other side of the break here on Girls Talk, Boys Talk.
At Jigsaw Dating, we obviously want the Cowboys to bring that sixth ring home. But to be honest, we're more focused on finding the person who will put a ring on your finger. That's why we created a dating app that reveals your face through meaningful conversation, so you can date deeper. Because it's personality that matters the most, not looks. Join Jigsaw Dating today, dating partner of the Dallas Cowboys.
If you've been thinking about weight loss surgery, My Bariatric Solutions has made it easier for you to schedule your initial consultation from the safety, comfort, and convenience of your own home. You'll meet one-on-one with a bariatric surgeon over a private and secure video call. You'll learn everything you need to know about the options available and which procedure is best for you. If you've been considering weight loss surgery and are ready to take the first step, call My Bariatric Solutions today at 844-326-6266. That's 844-326-6266, or go to mybariatricsolutions.com.
Dear past, present, and future football watchers, you know why we're here. The football season is back! Woo! And since that's too amazing to miss a single second's worth, Pepsi is officially giving you permission to always put football first. Like, maybe those in-laws are back in town. Well, better hope they're football fans, because your Sunday is completely booked. Long story short, crack open a Pepsi and don't let anything get between you and your football watching. With love, Pepsi. Made for football watching. That's what I like.
Hi, I'm Danny McCray, Dallas Cowboys alumni player here with Smoothie King. And Smoothie King wants to ask you, what's that sound? Yeah!
That's the sound of you and everyone else absolutely loving new smoothie bowls from Smoothie King. And woo, me too. These smoothie bowls start with acai and pitaya and are handcrafted with fresh toppings like sliced bananas, sweet berries, crunchy Purely Elizabeth granola, and a savory peanut butter drizzle. New smoothie bowls, only at Smoothie King, the official smoothie of the Dallas Cowboys.
Girls Talk Boys Talk, presented by Jigsaw, the preferred dating partner of the Dallas Cowboys. We're going to talk about the draft, but first, Jess has some good information that if you are a taco lover, you're going to want to hear this.
Well, you can head over to the Miller Lighthouse at AT&T Stadium for the Dallas Cowboys Tacos and Tunes Festival presented by Miller Lite on Saturday, mark your calendars, May 13th from 2 to 7 p.m. Enjoy a variety of tacos and food truck options while you sip on cold drinks and listen to live music. Admission and parking for Dallas Cowboys Tacos and Tunes Festival is free. So visit ATTstadium.com/tacosandtunes for more info. We will see you there. You know, I'm all
two
for
of
some
my
tacos
favorite
and
things.
Tunes.
You know,
tacos
I'm so greedy. I'm so greedy because the reads you've done, probably this whole season.
That's the one you like the most?
Them tacos get your attention.
That's
the word
so good.
Tacos just like.
Well, let's see. May 13th. Mark your calendar right now.
May 13th. And that is a good day because it's also the second day of rookie minicamp.
Oh, it's going to be good lit. Transition. That was good.
Our new rookies will be making their way in the building next week. Next week's going to be crazy, crazy town at the Star in Frisco. A lot of crazy things happening. We've got schedule release. I know our creative team is working so hard to have a really cool schedule release video, so be on the lookout
that.
For that. We've also got the American Country Music Awards happening on the red carpet, so that will be fun, too.
Garth and Dolly.
I'm excited for that as well. I'm not a big country music person, but they asked me to be on the red carpet. I'm not sure why.
Do it.
Okay.
So I am super excited for that as well.
Push
so we'll have to do some study sessions because I'm gonna need like flashcards.
I got you.
I'm
always.
You'll know the words.
I don't know who these people are.
I'll be
what
like,
they look like.
This is Garth Brooks. Big deal. Very big deal. This is Dolly Parton. Also very big deal.
I'm just. Waiting.
I got you.
Bow, 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 bow. That's what I think about.
You
the
know
guitars.
What's really cool, actually, is so there's murals in at the Star right now of Garth and Dolly, and I always joke around that Garth Brooks is the reason that I got my first TV job because that's at his interview that's where I had actually met the people that got me the internship, and so I'm like, oh, full circle, Garth's out front and here he is again. And so I always love just giving Garth the credit where credit is due. Thank you, Garth, for my career.
Hey.
give me a Garth Brooks song.
Friends in Low Places. I'm
oh,
sure you
know
that
one.
Yes,
I know that
I've
one
got friends.
All right, y'all, well,
low
next week if y'all
places.
See me walking around in cowboy boots, mind your business. I'm just getting in character. So obviously, like I said, we have a lot going on that day, and then that day is also the day that our rookies will report to the Star, and then they get underway with their first official workouts as professional athletes on Friday. We will have a lot of media availability with them, but I kind of just want to start off the top and we'll work our way down. Mazi Smith, pick number one off the board, was a little bit of a curveball to a lot of people. There was so much talk about the Cowboys taking a tight end or trading up to get a running back, and then in perfect Cowboys fashion, mm-hmm. they go completely into left field, and they're like, give me a D-tackle, baby. Give me a big boy. But you know what? I spent the day with Mazi when we picked him up from the airport, and I basically just hung out with him for the day, rode the bus with him over to the Star and walked around with him and his mom. And I got to be honest, guys, I did not know what to expect when it came to Mazi. We know the physical attributes that he brings to the table. He's physical, he's tough, he's strong. We've
Look
seen the
go.
Videos. But to me, the thing that stood out, and this is how I know he's already going to fit in with this group, his personality, guys, is he is one of the best people I've met. And that's like football player aside. He describes himself as a jokester, but he's not a prankster. There's a difference.
Oh,
so he doesn't
good.
Pull pranks, but he likes to be funny. He likes to be a jokester. He's most excited to work out with Osa Odighizuwa and learn from Osa, which I don't think you can pick a better guy in the locker room from that perspective, besides a Jonathan Hankins to learn from. But the number one thing that stood out to me about Mazi is his humility. And we describe a lot of these players as humble, right? But there's a difference, I think, between you know, saying that you're humble and not saying that you're humble, but people can recognize that. And one of my favorite moments with Mozzie last week was during his official welcoming press conference. Somebody asked him about what it meant to play for the Cowboys or how excited he was. And, you know, he talked about, I'm excited, I'm honored to be here. And then he turned and looked at Mike McCarthy and he said, thank you for this opportunity. I won't let you down.
Oh, my heart.
And it's just, it's the little things with these guys, right? Because we break them down so much as players. We analyze, you know, how their hand grip is when they're trying to take down a tackle. You know, we analyze their footwork or how their lateral ability. But to have the gratitude right off the top, this is a, what, 22, 23-year-old kid. Mm-hmm. To look your coach in the eyes and say, thank you for letting me be here. I mean, it was just incredible. I'm excited for him just to get into the locker room, get to work. This is a strong boy.
Yeah.
He's a strong boy.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I also wanted to say thank you to you for the work that you did. I think it's important.
No, you guys are killing me.
No, like, not even trying to be.
It was amazing.
We talk about it so much on this show, and it doesn't get highlighted a whole bunch because, I mean, like I said, on the draft show, like you just mentioned, like we're talking about the X's and O's and all that stuff, but that part of it is so important, and I feel like Mike McCarthy, since he's been here, so many of the guys that they draft are high character. I think somebody described Mozzie as Tyler, but defense.
I described him as Sam Williams.
Yeah. Sam.
Sam's personality. I can see where the Tyler Smith comes from, but I think he, personality-wise, Sam Williams to a T, just maybe like a scooch more mature. And I love Sam. I love Sam. Yeah. Sam's a little bit more goofy, bit more aloof. Mozzie has that same kind of personality, just like a hair more together.
You know what was interesting is, so obviously Mozzie was part of the 30 visits for the Cowboys, and Mike talked about how during that visits, you're not just during those visits, I should say, oh my goodness, good morning. During those visits, you're not really just looking at football. You're looking at character traits, personality, everything within the scope that makes a good player both on and off the field. And so what I like is that Mike really does emphasize, hey, we want good guys that are productive on the field, but good guys that outside of this locker room, when you're not here, I know you're going to be a good guy and you're going to do the right thing. So even just how Mozzie was talking about his mom.
I loved his mom.
In the post-conference, the post-draft
12 out of 10.
It was so sweet watching her reaction. I was watching her most of the time. I was like, oh, it's so sweet. But he said he wants to show his mom things bigger than she thought she could ever experience. Mm-hmm. And that...
Wanted to expose her to things she'd never been exposed for.
So many
and there was so... Yeah, there were so many players in this year's draft. I go back to Quentin Johnston, rather, out of TCU on his draft party. That was the first thing he said about his mom. He said, hey, mom, you're putting in your 2 weeks. You're retired now.
So retired. Sweet. But I wanted to say that I was glad that you were one of the first people. Like when I saw that you went to pick him up in like the airport, I was lit because I was excited because I know that you understood. I think that it means something for our media and whoever to make these guys feel comfortable to talk. And he seemed like he was so comfortable talking to y'all. And I think, like I said, I felt like it was important watching your interviews and stuff I felt like you made that spot comfortable for them to be open, and that's important to what we do. So I wanted to say thanks, because we learned a lot about him that you don't know if they were gonna be if he was gonna be open like that. Yeah. But also too, you mentioned the 30 visits. The Cowboys use these 30 visits to make some decisions.
Yeah,
and it sounds like
Mike
they were
Jerry talked about that.
Right. Yeah. It sounds like they were sure about Mozzie a long time ago, and we were in denial because it's been so long since you've seen them take a DT. We talked about it, though. It was too hard to ignore how good this defense was when Jonathan Hankins was in.
Yeah.
And if you didn't need any more evidence, like you saw the drastic difference in numbers, almost a yard difference in the run game when he was out there. Yeah. Let's go ahead and emphasize DT and see how much better this defense gets. And they did that. Attitude, personality, all of that. Mozzie's a hard worker too, like you said, Jess, and you're not going to have to tell him to get out there and work. You're not going to have to tell him to be on time and everything. And that, again, I feel like that's something they're really looking for in the gentleman they're bringing in here.
And I think something that is comparable to Tyler Smith and making that comparison is they're both coachable guys.
Very
they want
coachable.
To be coached. They want to get better. They want to grow. And something that Micah actually pointed out last night that I thought was really interesting point that Cowboys Nation really hasn't thought about is he mentioned the loss of Carlos Watkins this offseason, and he said Mozzie really helps fill that gap because that was a big loss, essentially. Yes. My words, like paraphrasing his, but Micah also said, you know, just losing Carlos was big. So having Mozzie, a young guy coming in like this, he said a big boulder coming in like this is really helpful.
Micah boulder. Micah funny.
Micah was really competitive last night, let me just say.
Micah won't his life to be easier. He is all for DT, but I'm so glad you mentioned the loss of Carlos Watkins, because you described Mozzie as a jokester. Is that what you said?
Yeah, that's how he described himself. Not a prankster. He's not going to pull pranks, but he is a jokester.
The replacement. Carlos Watkins was the same way. He's a jokester himself, so the replacement, that's funny. That's funny that you mentioned that. But the play from Carlos Watkins that you got was so underrated. It was so underratedly good, and you felt the difference of when he wasn't there. Mozzie as a pick, I was totally okay with, because I was like, oh, y'all ain't playing about getting ran on no more. Y'all are not playing.
And I love that you bring that up, too, because that was such a talking point at the draft. We had the opportunity in Kansas City to talk to so many of these insiders who've been covering this, like, from the jump, you know what I mean? And the number one thing that everybody said is, if you're not going to trade up to get a Bijan Robinson or a Jahmyr Gibbs, then you need to address the run defense. And I know it wasn't probably like the sexiest pick off the top, because there was so much conversation, like I said, about taking a tight end or taking a running back or even looking at what wide receivers were available at the time. But all of the guys I talked to, Charles Davis, Daniel Jeremiah, Joel Klatt, all of those guys said, you need to shore up your run defense, because That was where you lacked. You can't have an elite defense if you're allowing these guys to run on you. So I love the pick. I love also the addition of Luke Schoonmaker. I know that there's conflicting views on the pick. But what a lot of people aren't taking into account is that when you lost Ezekiel Elliott, you weren't just losing a running back.
Say it,
you're
girl.
Losing a big part of your pass protection. You're losing a big blocker. That was one of the things that he was strong at, and guess what Luke is really good at?
Yeah,
tell us, Aisha.
Yeah, absolutely.
Tell us what he's good at.
He's good at blocking, my friends. And not only is he good at blocking, he's good at blocking all across the line. Like, he can do it all, and that was something that seemed very important after talking to the tight ends coach. After Luna Wells actually came in and sat and talked with us, it was on the draft show. Sorry, it was important that Luke is almost like a plug-and-play player, because at the level that he's playing, he was playing in a pro-level offense, and the things they were asking him as a tight end were pro-level. So it's going to be easier to plug-and-play him. But I also feel like Luke, and this draft in itself, especially with Luke, kind of shows you some of what Mike McCarthy wants to do in this offense. And it may look different than what we've seen before, but Lunda mentioned the 12, 13 personnel, some of the stuff we loved last year. This allows them to continue to do that. But this tight end room is so versatile. You got guys that can do some of everything, some guys that do things very well. And if you want to run the ball, you can get behind Luke Schoonmaker. If you want Jake Ferguson to kind of slip out, you know, as he's running the ball, do some Travis Kelce type stuff, he can do that. Peyton Hendershot through the seams. Like, there's a lot. McCune. Oh, actually, I think Patrick posted his little interview with Luke, and he actually mentioned Sean McCune being one of his mentors, They're both Michigan guys, and he learned a lot from him. So there's some camaraderie in this room. Luke is a good addition to the room. I know a lot of people were concerned because they felt like the Cowboys took him earlier. But one thing you'll learn about the draft is that when you're picking at the end of the round, you're at the mercy of everyone else. Yep. And it was very nerve-wracking for them to think that maybe someone might take Luke Schoonmaker. And like I said, this guy he's done pro-level stuff. So I think we would be remiss to think that other teams weren't interested in him being a plug-and-play tight end for them as well. So, I think a lot of him, his addition is what Mike McCarthy wants to do with this offense, and I'm excited. And Shoddy.
And not only that, too, but you talk about a guy that the Cowboys weren't able to retain this offseason, Dalton Schultz.
Absolutely.
And that was a big loss for the Cowboys offense, especially when you talk about just the camaraderie within the tight end room in itself. But I was curious. I was like, what? How can we compare the two? Their size. They're actually the same height, both at 6'5". Luke weighs a little bit more at 249, and then Dalton was at 244. they just, it's interesting when I see people talking on Twitter, they're like, oh, he's a bigger guy than Dalton. No, they're actually the same height. The thing is that he stretches out more. I think of like Elastigirl from The Incredibles. Like, that's what I see when I'm watching film of Luke. And what is an issue that we talked about last season, not just with the tight ends, but even receivers on the offense? No separation. Guess what Luke is good at? He creates separation. Guys, I'm so excited for this. Y'all know I wanted a tight end in this draft.
We got one.
It wasn't who I was expecting, but it was one of those things that it's even better than I was expecting, because he fits the mold of this tight end room so well. The way, just his body shape, his skills, the agility, plug-and-play type player, like you said, Aisha.
Also, the personality.
Yeah.
You listen to Schoon talk. He's talking about the team and wanting to be better and just really being, you know, he's a very hard worker. His character checks out. So I think that's important as well moving forward for the tight end room, ladies, to have a hard worker, another hard worker in there to, you know, to fill the room.
Yeah, they're just a bunch of clowns.
They are a mess.
They're a mess. Shout out to Jake, though. He crushed the home run derby. There was a part of me yesterday that was like just this much sad when he didn't win the home run derby. Because I'm telling you, on the mic, you know, you're trying to fill the time, you're trying to figure out things to say. Jake batted so long in the first round that we ran out of stuff to talk about. He cranked out like 19.
Oh, who's that good?
Home runs.
He was good.
He made contact after contact after contact, because the way it works is, you know, like you get 8 outs, and out is anything that's not a home run. Mm. And so as long as you are making contact and you're getting the ball over the little white fence that they put up to count for a home run, you can keep batting. So that first round, I want to say Jake was batting in the first round for like 5 minutes straight, just cranking them out of the park, and did the same thing in the second. But what I liked about Leighton's approach is that he started a little shaky. He was the returning champion, so he had a lot of pressure on his shoulders. Took a second to get built up.
Yep.
But then in that third round, he crushed it.
He's so fake. He's so fake. I seen him last year because LVE, he come in so smooth, like, oh, what's up, guys? Just like,
His walk-up song was All I Do Is Win. Fake. So.
Oh, never. And it was so funny. During his interview, he's like, I'll pick it up, don't worry. And
then he did. He did.
It was good. He was somebody else I really enjoyed talking to yesterday. Leighton, we didn't see a lot of him in the locker room last season, so the interaction before that was very limited. But yesterday, got to talk to him a little bit more, which was just really cool to do in general. But what I loved him talking about, he's like, I felt like this was already a young team last season, but now it's even younger, and I'm the older guy, so it's a little weird. He talked about how Mozzie is huge up front, and something that I talked about last season with him a lot was he's a Dan Quinn guy. You're getting a Dan Quinn guy who talked about since day one, I met Dan Quinn, I was all in, just took one interaction with him. I asked him, I said, what is it like for you to see the team that Dan has built around really his coaching culture just in the last 3 years alone? He said, for the fact that Dan chose to stay and not take a head coaching job because he cares about our team and knows what we're capable of should say enough. That's everything to us. And so, you know, it makes them want to play harder knowing that Dan had that opportunity. And he's still here.
So yeah, they definitely play for him.
DQ guy.
Love that.
Did you ask him about DeMario and Overshown?
He said that he's just very excited to see what Overshown can do, just in general. And he said that his message to the younger guys, now that he's the older guys, like, it's really weird, is to enjoy the moment because it goes fast. So good advice.
Let's get into DeMario and Overshown when we get into the blah, 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 words today. We're going to take a break is what I'm trying to say. And when we come back, we will talk about DeMario and Overshown, and we will talk about the story of the draft next on Girls Talk Boys Talk.
At Jigsaw Dating, we obviously want the Cowboys to bring that sixth ring home. But to be honest, we're more focused on finding the person who will put a ring on your finger. That's why we created a dating app that reveals your face through meaningful conversation so you can date deeper. Because it's personality that matters the most, not looks. Join Jigsaw Dating today, dating partner of the Dallas Cowboys.
Dear past, present, and future football watchers, you know why we're here. The football season is back!
And since that's too amazing to miss a single second's worth, Pepsi is officially giving you permission to always put football first. Like, maybe those in-laws are back in town. Well, better hope they're football fans because your Sunday is completely booked. Long story short, crack open a Pepsi and don't let anything get between you and your football watching. With love, Pepsi. Made for football watching. That's what I like.
If you've been thinking about weight loss surgery, My Bariatric Solutions has made it easier for you to schedule your initial consultation from the safety, comfort, and convenience of your own home. You'll meet one-on-one with a bariatric surgeon over a private and secure video call. You'll learn everything you need to know about the options available and which procedure is best for you. If you've been considering weight loss surgery and are ready to take the first step, call My Bariatric Solutions today at 844-326-6266. That's 844-326-6266, or go to mybariatricsolutions.com.
I'm Dak Prescott, quarterback of the Dallas Cowboys. Blockchain.com is one of the most trusted ways to buy, sell, and trade crypto. Whether you're always on the go or stay closer to home, Blockchain.com is just a few taps away. Put the power of crypto in your pocket, so no matter where you are, you can trade on your terms and build a crypto portfolio to fit your life. For crypto pros, rookies, and anyone in between, Blockchain.com makes it easy to own a piece of the future. Blockchain.com, trusted by millions, trusted by America's team.
Minutes here on Girls Talk Boys Talk, presented by Jigsaw. We told you about tacos and tunes, and now we're going to tell you about some other fun opportunities for Cowboys Nation.
Yeah, register now for the 2023 Dallas Cowboys Youth Camps presented, good morning, by Invisalign. Athletes ages 6 to 16 are invited to learn from the best this summer at AT&T Stadium or the Ford Center at the Start in Frisco. Football camps are led by former NFL players, and dance camps are taught by current Dallas Cowboys cheerleaders. Here we go. Save $25. You know I love that. When you sign up for camp by May 12th, visit dallascowboys.com/camps for more info. That's so. I love saving some money.
Get your tacos, get your tunes, and then get your kid into camp so you can enjoy your tacos
that's
and tunes.
Genius. Haley, you're a genius. That was amazing.
Drop them keys out.
Drop them off.
Drop them off and then go enjoy your tacos and tunes.
Well, I ain't got no keys.
We have dogs. The same thing. We have pets.
We left off in the second block talking about our draft picks, and obviously one of the guys I'm super excited to have on this team is none other than DeMarvion Overshown out of Texas. This is a guy that we kept up with since the season. Senior Bowl. He told us at the Senior Bowl that he didn't have a dream team, that he didn't grow up supporting a team. But that was lies because he posted on his Instagram when he was in third grade that he was going to grow up to play for the Dallas Cowboys. So DeMarvion Overshown, I'm calling you out a little bit, but it's okay. You made it come to fruition. I thought that that was interesting, too, and Matt Owen actually pointed this out on Twitter when Overshown tweeted the picture. I know that it said like third because he was in third grade, but how ironic that he was our third round draft pick too. So you want to talk about the stars
so
aligning.
Cute.
I mean the cowboy hat too. Oh, I know I know he played for Texas, but the cowboy hat really set it off.
He's from the country. He's from ARP. ARP.
Ma'am?
ARP.
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 Like
just
A-A-R-P?
Outside of Tyler, Texas. Not AARP. ARP.
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 Wow. I've never
Texas.
Heard. I'll look it
Aww.
Up. I'm gonna look it up.
He's but, a, that's the kind of story you love, though. Like that is what makes the draft. The draft is when you have a guy that he was manifesting this since the third grade, guys. This was in his yearbook, signed, sealed, delivered. He said, "This is the team." I love that, and that hit my heart personally. Just I love that. But talking about his post draft call, his conference call. What I really liked about it is that. This quote went everywhere, but he said that Dan Quinn says he has a job to play everywhere and anywhere. So you, again, theme of this draft, versatility. You have another versatile guy in your defensive scheme for Dan Quinn to have just basically throw him where he needs to go. I'm excited.
Yeah.
I'm so excited.
He's a
this.
Converted safety, so he's got some safety playability, but also he can play that linebacker role really well. Aisha, I want to default to you on this because he's got some strengths and he's got some weaknesses. I imagine they are looking to start him off in special teams, especially given some of the guys who have left to fill some roles there. But when you look at his abilities and what he brings to the table, where can we expect him to shine and where are some areas that you think maybe coming into rookie camp and going into OTAs where he can develop so he can start competing for some of those game snaps in the season?
Absolutely. It's important because I feel like, especially with what we've learned about Micah going to DN full time, this I'll say ambiguity of just how Dan Quinn can use these different guys as rushers, drop them in coverage. Like, offenses might not know who's coming from where and what they're doing, and that's something that's important. But DeMarion, he mentioned the fact that Dan Quinn wants to play him all over, and I believe that. I believe that because of his ability. He flies to the ball. I've started to hear some of the comparisons, like attitude-wise, to Donovan Wilson. Yeah. And you can see that. Yes, you can see that. But also, too, he has some Jayron Kearse in him with the coverage ability and stuff. So you're getting a mix of those two guys. So a lot of it is tone setting, attitude, hitting, you know, really making people feel you. But one thing that impresses me about DeMarion is that in college, he was asked to do so much. It was a lot of coaching changes, mm-hmm. a lot of, hey, we need you over here to fill in. So we need you to play some linebacker. Hey, can you rush the passer a couple times? Because we're not mm-hmm. getting much from our DNs. And it reminded me very much so of Micah. In a sense of he's coachable, like you said, Jess, and he's okay with playing everywhere. Some of the weaknesses that you're going to see from him is that, though, is something that we worried about even with the Tyler Smith is like, hey, what is this guy's position and what is he going to do? Mm. He needs specific roles carved out for him so he's not looking confused and covered sometimes. And there were times that you saw him on film in Texas is that he did not. You could tell the processing wasn't there. You could tell he was not sure of what his assignment was. And that happens when you have players doing mm-hmm. so much in different places. So for him, I think it's important that whatever his role is or roles are, they're carved out early and he can perfect them.
Love that.
And that he has coaches that get behind him that believe in what he can do. And he can do it he can do it all. He can fly all over the field. You don't have to worry about him as much dropping in coverage, too, because we've seen offenses take advantage mm-hmm. of our linebackers mm-hmm. in coverage. This is something that you may not see from him. But if you're going to put on special teams, yeah, he can play. But I think that this gentleman might have a chance to actually play some linebacker with Micah going to DN full time. Mm.
Yeah, I love that. Last thing we'll talk about here, because there's so many things we can get into with this draft class, but I want to end it on such a high note. I don't think that there was a dry eye in this building when Deuce Vaughn's name was called in that draft. And I want to give you guys kind of a behind-the-scenes look at what happened. So, obviously, with our draft show that Aisha is on, you guys are monitoring the feed. You're getting to see the war room aspect of it. From our perspective, we're upstairs. You know, we're all kind of listening. We're tuned in. We've got our computers. We've got the draft on. Nick Eatman, who is our manager, is kind of the point guy between the war room and us. So around the fifth round is when he first came in and said they were talking about Deuce. So obviously we're all excited like that it's even conversation is coming to fruition. But when the sixth round rolled around and Nick sprinted into the room and said, it's Deuce. Mm. Everybody upstairs stood up. We all clapped. We were all so excited. And then you see the video that's on your screen right now of Chris Vaughn getting the opportunity to call his son and ask him to come to work. I mean, like, it's even hard to talk about right now. So really exciting stuff just from an emotional standpoint. The Cowboys hit it out of the ballpark with this draft pick. I'm excited to get Deuce in the building. I talked to him at the combine, and he was excited then. I know he'll be excited when he comes in next week. But emotions aside, Deuce Vaughn is a baller.
Yeah.
And I know that there's always going to be questions about his size. I mean, Bryce Young is this in the same mm-hmm. situation where people are always going to count him out or tell him that he's not good enough because he's small. Deuce is the same way. He's about my height. So that's what you can expect with Deuce when you're walking in the building. But he's a baller. The tape shows it. And not only does the tape show it, but in the press conference, the post draft press conference on Saturday when everybody was asking about Deuce, the coaching staff, the front office could not have been more complimentary in the best way about the skill set that he brings to the table. And I'm serious, y'all. Don't be surprised if this guy is lining up in the backfield making big plays. I mean, I think the natural place for him to start out is compete for reps as a returner with Kevontae Turpin. I think that's going to be a great battle that we'll see in training camp.
Right.
But I also think you combine him and Tony Pollard, look at him go.
Yeah.
I mean, like, this kid, I think, is really going to be special. It makes it better when they're good guys. But from a football standpoint, this is a guy that Cowboys Nation should be juiced up about.
Deuce with the juice. Period.
Did you see how I lobbed you for that?
No, I knew you were going. So I was like, thanks, girl. No, you know what I really like too is talking about his size. He, when we were asking about it right after the draft, he was like, I see it as an advantage. I'm able to be successful with it because he said he creates moves laterally with it. And what
he's slippery.
What I appreciate about it is not that he's an underdog in any way, but people look at him that way for the disadvantage with his size. Prove them wrong. Prove them wrong, Deuce. Come in with a chip on your shoulder. Prove them wrong and get you a starting position. Because what I envision, I'm just looking at my little Cowboys crystal ball, and I know you don't like crystals, but crystal ball.
Crystal ball I can do. Crystals that you're using around your head to make a decision on when you're going to retire, I'm out.
Oh, okay. Well, just to clarify.
I'm out.
good clarification. What I was worried about when Noah Brown left for the Texans was, who is your backup returner guy? If something, knock on wood, I don't know where there's some wood, happens to Kevontae. Because really at that point, is it CeeDee? Who would it be? I love that you have another special teams threat in here because it really makes guys have other teams less of an opportunity to study Kevontae and stop him. So now you have two threats when you have that. And again, that competition during training camp. So excited for that. But you have that in the bag with Deuce. Great. But then you also talk about the loss of Ezekiel Elliott and how obviously that impacts your 1-2 punch. Is that even going to be schematically what you see from a Mike McCarthy run offense here? You don't know yet. So for me, Deuce gives you the versatility in multiple aspects, and he just, the story overall, meant to be a Dallas Cowboy, written in the stars.
Yeah, you mentioned the competition at returner, and that's important. That's been important to Mike McCarthy since he's been here, that there's always competition in whatever position. But also, too, with Deuce, I'm excited about his ability to receive as a receiver.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. As a running back, he's insane. But at the same, and he can run between the tackles, too, y'all. Like, don't get it twisted. This guy is not physical. Like, there's instances where they use him to, you know, get short yardage situations. But the receiving capability is what makes him such a threat to me in the slot, coming out the backfield, quick slip stuff, where he's such a change of pace also. Mm-hmm. Too. I believe that defenses are going to struggle. And one thing that I think is so awesome about Deuce, and he mentioned the fact that his size is something that he sees as an advantage. We talked about it on the show with the two back set, Lightning and Thunder. The difference what made it hard for defenses to tackle Tony after they had to deal with Zeke was the fact that they're different. Like, they're different. Mm-hmm. The way that you're positioning your body, preparing angles, all that stuff to tackle. Imagine with Deuce, you're going to tackle him, and most of the gentlemen that you're tackling are 5 inches taller. So it's
almost like you have to adjust.
You have to
absolutely
learn how to.
Absolutely. Yeah. And so it is to him. He's been playing this height for almost his whole career. So he's learned how to beat people with that, and he's so quick. The decisions he makes on a dime to escape people is different. There's some things that he does that are different, and the explosiveness and the speed that he brings to this offense, I think, is going to make a difference. You've been looking for speed on this offense for a long time, and you have multiple guys who have it now. I think he's going to be a good addition, and he's definitely going to piss off some defenses. He's going to piss them off because imagine him running behind Schoon. Bye.
Man.
Last thing here before we go, your draft grade for the Cowboys.
Mm.
Just off rip. No, don't think about it too much. Just what initial thoughts?
I'm going to give them a B-.
Okay, B-.
I'm going with B-.
Yeah, I go B.
Yeah.
I go B.
B, 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 B. Because I had to understand about this draft, they know what they decided to do. Yeah. But everything that you look at, it makes sense. It makes sense for them. The player makes sense. You start looking at the film, it makes sense. It just makes sense that the gentleman that they brought in. Now, some of the guys, like, I got to get hip on some of these. Jalen Brooks, I got to get hip on some of them.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
they know what they want, and they know what they see. And after De'Ron Bland came in here last year.
Yeah, turned everybody
let
out.
Let me just not bother
Should
y'all.
Should I do it?
We are out of time here on Girls Talk Boys Talk. We've got rookie mini camp coming up later next week. A lot to talk about as well with the Cowboys organization. That'll do it for us here on Girls Talk Boys Talk. We'll get back with you next Thursday at 10.
This has been a production of DallasCowboys.com and the Dallas Cowboys Football Club. How about-